Hello and welcome, and thank you for joining me. Today we're going to look at all the awesome flow features that is coming up with winter 2022. So my environment is in pre-release mode, so we're able to access all the features. The release notes are not out yet, but I'll be sure to pin in the comments as soon as that gets out. Okay, let's jump right in. So the first feature I want to talk about is the list views. And now we did have list view features before, but now we are able to filter it even better. So for example, if I wanted to create a list view for all the account flows, I can now do that by using just creating a list view from this gear icon, just like you would in a normal list view. But here you just say these additional fields are now available. So you can just say triggering object. You can also select filter on trigger. If I wanted to do this, I can just say triggering object and make sure you're typing the API name of the object. And that is pretty much it. So it will give you all the account flows. You can also filter by type of flows. So like I have screen flows. So it will bring up all the screen flows that I have in the environment. And there are some additional columns as well. So how was it built and so on. So really awesome, especially for organizing and managing your tons of flows. All right, so the next feature is around the flow itself. Let's look at click on new flow, and right away you'll notice as you start to create a record triggered flow. So I'm gonna create a record triggered flow, and we will notice some subtle changes here. So the first step is the same, where the record is created, updated, deleted, and so on. And what I want to point out here is now you have this option, optimize the flow for. And this is, I think, the same thing as before and after. So before flow, but it wasn't as intuitive for non-developer to understand the before and after. So now they have fast fill updates and actions and related records. So fast fill updates is basically your before insert or before update. It doesn't make an extra save or update to the database, and is usually recommended for when you are trying to update certain fields on the same object. After updates is usually recommended if you wanted to do some related records or actions like that. So now you can use, and it explains it really nicely here, so you can just choose whichever options more fit with your use case. Okay, so I'm just going to select created or updated here and just select an account so we can look at more features. And so if you notice here, you also have an option for run asynchronous path. So I think that is only supported for after insert and update and not for before. So the use case for that would be, let's say you wanted to create a account or update an account and send an API call to a separate system. So more so for your future, just like the future methods in Apex or asynchronous Apex. And also you can use this for scenarios where you are running into mixed DML. So basically it will kind of have two threads. You're able to increase CPU time limit by using asynchronous path as well, if it doesn't need to happen right away. And usually it's very immediately. So I've seen lag for like 1 or 2 seconds. So we'll look more into that in a second. But and then the condition, as soon as you select this, you can, it's the same option as before. No changes there. So I'm just going to keep it this way and hit done. So now we're here in the flow builder. And once you land here, you'll notice right away that you have subflow. And the subflow was supported in Screenflow, but not on record triggered flow. So if you're not familiar with subflows, subflows are basically flows that you can call from within a flow. So it allows you for more flexibility in terms of, let's say, if you are reusing certain capability over and over again, you can put that all functionality in a subflow and then call that from different flows. That is one use case. Another use case would be to just simplify your flow. So right now, if you have multiple business owners for different types of account updates or account actions that they want to do on account creation or update, everything either ends up being in the same flow. So nobody wants to make changes to it, or you're really scared to make changes because it might break something else, or you end up having so many different flows and they're not related to each other, so it's really hard to troubleshoot. What you can now do is with Subflow is kind of have like a framework and pass different business requirements into those each subflows, so your main flow remains kind of unchanged, but then anytime something changes, you're changing your subflow as opposed to your main flow. So if something does break, it will only impact that functionality and not the entire flow. Okay, we'll probably do another video in a longer time, but for now, let's just stick with the subflow. I'm just gonna pull it here, and I already created an opportunity subflow. I'll show you what that looks like in a second, but it's an opportunity subflow, and all it is doing is just creating opportunity. If I can type it here, create opti. And as you're creating subflows, so let's take a look at that subflow. As you're defining a subflow, it's just literally I have an assignment element to assign all the different values for that opportunity. And I'm passing a record ID. So it doesn't have to be a record ID, you can call it anything you like, but make sure you have available for input checked. This is how you're gonna pass that account ID so that opportunity can be associated with that ID. Okay, so let's go back here, and since I have that input checked, I'll be able to pass the value from here. So in this case, since this is an account trigger, I can just say record.id, which should give me the account ID after this is created, which is why this also needs to be an after insert. It cannot be before because I'm passing it from here. So that's all I needed to pass. Now, a use case would be, let's say, in my case, I only want to create the opportunity if that based on account type. So I have the account type, and if the account type is customer, I want to do certain things here. Record.type equal to customer direct. So, and then you could add multiple outcomes, and based on how complicated your each outcome is, you can have subflows for each of different outcomes. It really depends on your use case. Sometimes it's simple to just have everything in the same flow. Sometimes you might want to divide them into different flows so that it's easier to look at and also to troubleshoot. So I'm just going to say run immediately, but if I had that option selected for asynchronous, if I select this option, I'll be given more option here as I try to connect these. Let me just show you that real quick. So that's another feature. So run immediately or run asynchronously. So I just want to select that run immediately for now. And then just pass the decision here and save. Winter 2022. And now you will see a warning here as soon as you save this. And that is because if you want to run something asynchronously, because my flow is currently set up as asynchronously, even if I'm not using that, it is telling me that you can only run this when a record is updated to meet the condition requirements or select the isChange operator in a condition. So that is important to note for running anything asynchronously or even setting that up asynchronously. So I'm going to, because I currently don't have any requirements, it doesn't let me save it without doing that. So I'm just gonna uncheck this. Save this. Cool, so that is about the subflow, and we'll debug this now just to see what it looks like. So run immediately and skip the condition. I cannot run in rollback mode, so I'll just pick an example here. And hit run. So hopefully that meets the criteria, and we'll see where it goes. And run immediately, it meets the decision. So as we see here, there we go. We have subflow called out, and it is passing that record ID from that account 001. And then it is assigning all the values that I set in my subflow, and then creating the opportunity records. Obviously this is a rollback, so it's not actually created, but see right here. Awesome, so let's go back to the flow. So that was one feature. Next feature I wanna talk about is the schedule path. So if you go to schedule path, you will see some new option, which is really exciting. One of the option is backside. So why this is important is, if you have ever run into CPU time limit error, because Salesforce always batches things by 200, and especially if you are running something for large volume, sometimes you'd want to make sure the batch size is smaller. So if your org is pretty simple and less automations, this might not even be a problem for you. But sometimes I've had issues where I had to set the batch size to 5, for example, which is really bad, but sometimes it's kind of, you have to. So it's good to have that option so you can lower the batch size if needed, especially if you have so many automations. So it actually improves CPU time limit, but and governor limits. So read this statement here. And then another option is also, which I don't know if this was already there, but you can now do minutes after, and also like literally 1 minute or 5 minutes. So that's schedule paths. But try to see if you can actually do a asynchronous instead of doing schedule paths, if possible for your use case, and if you're able to define the criteria upfront. So that's all about the record triggered flow that I could find. Now let's look at Screenflow, and there's just one feature I want to talk about on Screenflow. And if you go to Screenflow, click New and select Screenflow, you'll be here, and you'll see Rollback Records. I just want to briefly introduce this one. So basically, a use case for this would be, let's say if you wanted to, you had a bunch of screen elements and create records, and based on certain decisions, you wanted to kind of roll back everything and not create anything, depending on the requirement. So sometimes it doesn't make sense to create the related record if one of the records failed after that. If a lead was created, you wanted to create a task for that lead record. For whatever reason, if the task creation failed, you might also want to not create the lead or roll back that. So that's literally what it does. I'll have a different video to kind of show an example for this, but just wanted to kind of walk you through this particular feature, which is really new and pretty awesome. So you can use this as a fault path, as I have here, or you can use it after a decision element. All right. I think that is all I could find, but let me know if you found something else. And also, please reach out if you have questions and comments. Thank you so much for watching.